Test.
Check. Check.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you. Thanks for coming out on this dreary, drippy day. But we'll take it anytime we can get it, right? I mean, we're Southern Californians. We need the water and the rain, so it's a good thing. Let me just welcome those who are online, and we're so glad that you could join us. And if you'd like to join us in person, we'd love to see you here. And everyone is invited out into the patio, and it's okay, it's covered, so you won't get wet, and to have a little coffee or a refreshment and just connect with one another and fellowship. Don't forget that on Wednesday nights, we have a great Bible study at 7 o'clock in our fellowship hall. It's called Deep and Wide, and they're going through the Gospel of Mark, and we invite everyone to come. It's team-led by all of our pastors in the congregation, so I'd encourage you to come and be a part of that. We're going to have a time of prayer after worship service back in the bride's room, or we'll call it the prayer closet. How about that? And if you have special needs, we'd love to have you come back, and we have a little prayer team that will be there available for you. You know, next week is Worldwide Communion Sunday, and we're going to have a wonderful gathering together in communion with the Lord, along with everyone who participates around the world. So keep that in mind. But we're also taking our peace and global witness offering, one of the special offerings of the Presbyterian Church. In your pew racks is a little brochure about this offering and some envelopes if you're interested in looking at what that's about. But we have this little video that we'd like to show now. Talks about one way that the peace and global witness offering is used.
When the prophet Elijah, deep in the throes of an existential crisis, fled to Mount Horeb in search of God, he was met instead by the sound of sheer silence. Natalie Pisarek knows just how he felt. There was a time in my life where I was at the bottom. Natalie testified during Sunday worship in her home congregation of First Presbyterian Church in Boonton, New Jersey. I cannot even describe how hard and difficult that time was. Only those who have been there know how it feels. Natalie's story recollected a significant turning point in her life. On that fateful day, I went for a walk in the wooded area where I kept repeating over and over in my wounded brain how I would end the pain. As I walked, I came across a field which oddly seemed to call to me. As I walked into the field, a beam of warm sunlight hit my face. It was this exact moment that I realized I had made a terrible mistake. It was like God was saying to me, "What are you doing? You have a reason to live." I was so overcome. Natalie found herself compelled to address the growing mental health crisis, not only by sharing her story with her church, but also by getting her congregation involved. The church's board of deacons was persuaded to take immediate action to address the suicide crisis. Because deacons in the Presbyterian tradition are called to a service of compassion, witness, and service, the board voted to designate the church's share of the Peace and Global Witness offering to support the New Jersey chapter of the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. It's an organization in which Natalie had participated for years. Natalie's personally moving experience resonates anew during the pandemic and underlies the importance of this work. Sadly and tragically, our community has lost more people to suicide in 2020 than it has to COVID-19, said Natalie. Through the Peace and Global Witness offering, congregations are encouraged and equipped to find and address the anxiety and discord that is prevalent throughout the world. The offering supports ministries that work for reconciliation and facilitate healing. So half of the Peace and Global Witness offering goes to the National Church to address these issues around the world. 25% is retained by the congregation for local peace and reconciliation work, and 25% goes to mid-councils for similar ministries on the regional level. Natalie has a message to share with us all during these unsettling times. And she reminds us to listen and look for the light. And remember that you have a purpose too. God is with you. Let us pray. Loving God, when we walk in the valley of the shadow, remind us that we are only steps from your light. Draw nearer to life by the arms of our shared ministry, all who feel hopeless, lost, or deserted, into your loving embrace, into the warmth of your sight. Amen.
The Lord is here. Let us prepare to worship him. That means it's time to set aside thoughts of what to cook for dinner or where we must go after the service. Jesus said, "So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat?' or 'What shall we drink?' or 'What shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them, but seek first the kingdom and his righteousness." But that means it's time to set aside those words of hurt that lay on your heart today. Jesus said, "Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all manners of evil against you for my name. Rejoice, be glad, because great is your reward in heaven." That means it's time to stop worrying about the money you don't have. Jesus said, "What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul?" It's time to set aside thoughts of illness and discomfort. Jesus said, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." The call to worship means that we have entered God's presence. It's time to quiet our minds of the extraneous thoughts. It's time to sing songs of praise, listen to hear the message behind, the meaning behind the message that Pastor Mike has prepared about Nehemiah's prayer. And we will offer our joys and concerns to our God. Let's take a moment of silence while we set aside all of these life events and ready ourselves to worship our Lord. A moment of silence. Holy Father, we turn our thoughts to you with a grateful heart. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your words of life Thank you for forgiveness for our daily missteps. Thank you for instilling in us courage to follow you by feeling your presence, reading your word, and repenting of our sinful ways. Come, sit beside us as we worship you and you only. We offer this gratitude to you, Lord, in your Son's name. Amen.
Good morning. This next song is one that is in a call-response kind of a format. So it's called I Will Worship. And on the verses, I will sing a verse, a word, a phrase. I will worship. And in parentheses, you come back with.
We echo.
I will worship. Yeah,
let's try that again. I will worship.
I will worship.
With all of my heart. You got it. That's how that's going to go. When we get to the chorus, you won't see anything in parentheses. We're all going to sing that together. That's, I will give you all my worship. Okay, but then verse 2, we'll be back to call response. And I think you got it now. I will worship.
I will worship
with all of my heart.
With all of my heart.
And I will praise you.
I will praise you
with all of my strength.
All my strength.
I will seek you.
I will seek you
all of my days.
All of my days.
And I will follow all of your ways.
All your ways.
Everyone, I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. And you alone are worthy of my praise. I will bow down,
I'll
hail you as King, and
I will serve you,
give you everything,
I will lift up
my eyes to your throne. good job.
So let us now stand and sing a hymn called Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Start worship as we have lifted praises to our Lord and Savior and Father and Holy Spirit. And so why do we lift praises? We're grateful for all his grace and his mercy that he's given to us, all his gifts of love and resources and provision. And so it's important for us to thank him, to respond to his gifts, to the giving of our time, our energy, and resources to him. Let us take a moment and reflect on that, and also let us pray. Lord God, thank you for your love, your grace. Thank you for your sacrifice on our behalf, that our sins would be forgiven, that we would have new life in you. Thank you for rising us up out of our darkness, our brokenness, and giving us life in Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to share this life with others, and so we give of our time, our energy, we rededicate our resources to you. Bless these gifts, O Lord, multiply them like the loaves and fishes. Feed people, not only physical food, but to feed them with your word. Feed them with deliverance from whatever darknesses they're in. We pray this in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,
will disappear.
Thank you. It was a great intro into the message today. So we're headed for the promised land. Is this on? No. Is this on now? It's on mute. Okay, it's off mute now. Okay, so we'll go to this microphone. Good. All right. Like I was saying, we're going to be coming out of Babylon back in Nehemiah's day and headed to the promised land. And by the way, just a little personal note, I'm glad for Will to step in last minute last week. Pastor Will, thank you very much. And everyone, I had a cold symptoms at the end of 2 weeks ago. It's worship service, and I thought I'd better get a COVID test, so I went and got a home test. Took me forever to find one because they're sold out everywhere. And it tested positive. Whoa. So I went over to Cal State San Marcos and got the official test, and that came back negative. So I did it again one more time just to make sure, and that one came back negative too. So I don't have COVID. I never lost my taste or smell. It was a regular cold, and it went away really fast. So I think I'm okay. So thanks for your prayers. I think maybe prayer worked. What do you think? All right. Along with, the brokenness of our world with COVID and diseases, cancers, I heard of another friend recently that's been diagnosed. There's so much brokenness and sickness and trials and tribulations that people are going through. And we're faced with just so many challenges in this world. Massive changes in immigration and health issues, housing shortages and education challenges are just to name a few. And these challenges and more tend to overwhelm us and drive us to the point where we just don't want to think about it. We retreat into our safe spots and try not to get too depressed over all of these challenges that are around us. It's like the old circling of the wagons, to protect ourselves. And we think, if only someone else will address this particular problem or that particular problem, and we think it will be someone else instead of God maybe calling me to do something about that, well, that's precisely against this attitude that God has called the church to be the answer. To be the someone or the agency of redemption and change in this world. So think about the parable of the Good Samaritan for a second. Remember, that was the one where the unexpected person came to the aid and the help of one who had been beaten and robbed on the side of the road, instead of those who were expected to be the compassionate one. Jesus taught that one person, even an unexpected individual who is inconvenienced, can be that agent of redemption. I believe that the church is the place where long-lasting change begins in a small way to transform a community. I believe as the people of God respond to the needs of the people around them, that the greater effect is a changed world, like dropping a rock in a pond and watching the rings moving out. Every act of love, every act of kindness, every act of care starts going out further than you ever dreamed, touching others. God's message to the world is a message of divine security and peace, which transcends our earthly challenges and unveils God's loving provision. When a person discovers that God, through his church, is reaching out to them amid their brokenness to provide a loving path to wholeness, to restore the downcast and the oppressed and the brokenhearted, God will get the glory and change and transformation will take place. Today's text is an example of how one person was moved with compassion for his people, for his community, for his city, and did something about it. All right, so let's pray. Lord God, we pray that your Spirit would open up to us your Scripture, your Word, that transforms our hearts and minds to align us with your will to be done in this world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to look at the character called Nehemiah in the Old Testament. And so hear the Word of God as I read verses 1 through 11 in chapter 1. The words of Nehemiah, son of Helkanah, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year where I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that survived the exile and also about Jerusalem. And they said to me, those who survived the exile are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. So when I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And then I said, O Lord God of heaven, great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and obey his commands, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you, and we have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws that you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place that I have chosen as a dwelling of my own name. They are your servants, your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord God, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. I was a cupbearer to the king. God bless to us the reading and the hearing of his word. Now, the book of Nehemiah is a kind of autobiography, there it is. Wow, that's a tongue twister, I don't know why, of a layman that God had called to bring restoration and renewal to a world that had changed dramatically. Now, God used Nehemiah to be a leader in the reconstruction of Jerusalem during the third return of the Israelites back to Judah. Now, here's a diagram of the timeline about that. Can you see pretty much what's going on? Yeah, so the exile started back in 606 B.C., a little over 600 years before Christ. The first return took place during Ezra, coming back, and he concentrated on rebuilding the temple and a house of worship. And then the story of Esther took place in between that and the second return, which was also during Ezra, chapters 7 through 10 of Ezra. And the third return is where we are now, with Nehemiah being called of God. He's being moved with compassion for the walls to be rebuilt in Jerusalem, which would give them definition and protection going forward. These two books, Ezra and Nehemiah, show us the sovereignty of God and his faithfulness to restore that which was broken, of which Jeremiah had prophesied about the exile, and that it would take 70 years before the returns would begin. But he also prophesied in chapter 29, very familiar piece of scripture for all of us. Let me read that to you, beginning at verse 10. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come, pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. I will be found. Don't you love that? You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. I will be found, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. And so this is beginning to happen. And over the course of many, many, many years, the people of Israel, the descendants of Israel and Judah, started back from Babylon, their captivity, to repopulate the promised land, heading back to the promised land, as you guys sang about. The physical work that these men did was also symbolic of what God was doing in the hearts of his people. He was rebuilding their faith and their commitment to him. They had a new mission in life, a mission that would take them from their familiar surroundings and comforts back, you know, after all, they'd been there a long time, or they were born there in captivity. They didn't know too much different. Their mission was to be vessels through which God would speak to the world as a people, his people. And they were to demonstrate through their lives and through their community the love and faithfulness of their God. Now, the picture of Jerusalem in ruins is an image of a community that has lost its defenses against attack and remained vulnerable to repeated hurt and pain. So Nehemiah is an example of how God can work miracles through one person to bring about positive changes in this world of hurt and disappointment, to bring back identity, belonging, and place where God meets us, God calls us, where we're to be together, where we get instructions for going back out into the world together and demonstrating God's love. Well, Nehemiah had been born into the captivity during Babylon's exile, during the exile in Babylon, and so he had never seen Jerusalem or Judah, and all he knew was that he had been taught about what he had been taught about and studied as he practiced his faith in God. He had read and studied the scriptures and knew the sacred stories of God's interaction and covenant with his people. He desired to serve the God of Abraham and Jacob, Moses and David. And while living in exile in the foreign land, he still maintained an attitude of servanthood toward God and his people. He had faith that one day the Jews would return to Jerusalem, where God promised to dwell with his people. So Nehemiah wanted to know how the rebuilding of Jerusalem was coming along. And so he encountered his brother Hanani and some other men that came from Judah, and he questioned them. And they reported to him that the walls were still torn down, the gates were still burned with fire. We don't find out until the last verse of this chapter that Nehemiah had a highly respected job in the court of the king of Persia. He was the king's cupbearer. Now, what that means is that he was the guinea pig, or the servant who would taste the king's food or his wine, his drink, and make sure that it wasn't poison. If it was poison, guess what? He would give his life in service to the king. Kind of like our Secret Service guys around the president. This was a very important job and a highly respected and trusted position. So he lived in with fine clothes. Thank you. Our Christian dog, Maisie, was agreeing. So he lived with fine clothes in this great palace and served the king in a very important role. I mean, a lot of people would like to see the king, in any government really, would like to see the king, you know, move on. And this king, Artaxerxes, reigned for a long time. I don't know if you could bring up that diagram once again, but on the bottom of the diagram shows the kings that, you know, Cyrus and Darius and Xerxes, and then Artaxerxes followed him. That was the longest reigning king of this period and the one in power at the time of Nehemiah. So we see in these first three verses, that Nehemiah was concerned about the welfare of the people of Jerusalem. He felt more compassion, and it was more important for him to know what was going on in Jerusalem and how he might be able to help, even more important than his prized position in the court of the king. People mattered to him more than these other things. So broken walls meant frightening insecurity, negligible commercial development, and serious economic deprivation. It meant his people were depressed, and they mattered more to him than anything. And so the walls needed some attention. He was moved with compassion to do something about this. He was moved to pray. At first, he cried. And he wept. And then he spent days before the Lord. And he fasted. He did without food to remind him to pray before the Lord, to show God how much he was moved also. Now, if we take Jerusalem as a symbol of our lives today, we can surely see the resemblance. There are many people in our community, even here today, who are struggling with broken down walls that used to give them identity and security. There's no longer any ability to resist destructive attacks by the enemy. They fall victim to sinful habits such as gossip or destructive criticism or lying or stealing or sexual misconduct or greed. Their defenses have been removed. The ways in and out of through their gates into their hearts are no longer working, and anything can come and go through into them. So like most, these people would like to have a determination to rebuild their lives, to get better, to be renewed in their faith and moral service and resolve. And so with God's help, they can be redeemed. They can rebuild the divine walls that give us identity and purpose and security. Well, God moves his people with compassion to do something to help these people so desperate for loving transformation in their lives. So down through the history of Christianity, God called ordinary people who became concerned and moved with compassion for the welfare of others. And the stories are innumerous. I'll just give you a few of those stories that where these people made a priority of life to do something about the needs of others. And so they didn't think of their own safety or their own well-being. They sacrificially worked on behalf of the Lord, helping others. And so Jesus taught greater love has no one than to lay down his life for his friends. And here's a list of a few of those who did this. We see in the life of William Wilberforce, and others who campaigned against slavery in England. And we saw it in George Mueller, who also had compassion for orphaned children and took prayerful and practical steps to make sure that they were cared for and provided for, had shelter, food, and clothes. We saw it in Mother Teresa of Calcutta, who brought mercy and love to the poor and dying out in the streets, and dignity for those. And we've seen it in the outpouring of help for the hungry in our community through volunteers who work in our food pantry and our food ministry distribution service, but also in our tutoring program and in Operation Hope just down the street. Nehemiah was so moved by this report about Jerusalem that he wept and he was moved deep within himself to do something about it. And so he prayed. Who are we moved for? Who has God put on our hearts? The homeless? Refugees? By the way, we're going to have a lot of refugees coming to San Diego County, both from Afghanistan and from other parts of the world. There's an organization that our presbytery is supporting, and they said that they've been allocated 510 refugees from Afghanistan to care for and provide for and, you know, find housing. And, you know, so we're going to have the world coming here for mission. Who are we moved for? Victims of terrorism, divorcees, widows, lost souls? God is calling his people to have a heart that moves us to do something and not expect someone else to do it. After Nehemiah is moved to do something about the plight of the Jews in Jerusalem, his next step was not to strategize ways to help. It was to spend time in prayer, seeking God's guidance. He knew that he was only one person that if he were to do anything worthwhile, that he needed to seek the power and the strength and the might of the awesome God that he loved. He needed time to enter the very presence of the Lord, to weep before him, to be reminded of his greatness, to confess his sins and the sins of his people. This is important because it shows us that this was not an extraordinary person. It was an ordinary person, just like you and I, who was moved to compassion and sought out the God of mercy to do something. It's important because it shows us that while this was a gifted lay leader, he felt like he needed to rely on prayer more than anything else. Here in the first chapter, we see the first of 9 prayers throughout the book of Nehemiah, where he went first to the Lord for prayer, in prayer, to seek his guidance in order to accomplish his mission of rebuilding the walls. He was committed to prayer. His prayers were genuine and sacrificial. They were persistent. They were prayers of encouragement, and that he was confident in his prayers that God would respond. And he kept praying until he did receive guidance and provision. So Nehemiah spent days in prayer, and he fasted before doing anything. James writes, of course, we looked at the book of James this last summer. In James 5, he wrote, "The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective." How do we get to that righteous place in our prayer life where our prayers are powerful and effective? It's only in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, who died for us, whose blood was spilled for us that we might be righteous in him. And so that's where Nehemiah starts. He's so moved with compassion for his people that he's driven to prayer. In verses 5 through 11, we see the progression of Nehemiah's prayer, which we can use as a model for our own prayers of intercession. First of all, he recognized the greatness of God. He understood that he needed to remind himself that God is great and not him. That God is the creator and the provider and mighty, and with God nothing was impossible. This prayer begins in verse 5 with a reminder of who God is. He says, "O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant with of love with those who love him and obey his commands." That's a great place to start. What does Jesus remind us to do when he taught us to pray? Our Father who art in heaven. God is our Father in heaven. He's to be holy. So he reminds himself that God's more powerful than anything in the universe. He is the God of the covenant with Israel, who has protected, provided, and sustained them. And when we are moved to help others, we need to remind ourselves that God can do the impossible when it seems a hopeless endeavor. He is all-powerful. Secondly, Nehemiah turns his prayer focus on repentance of his personal sins and the corporate sins of the nation of Israel. He writes in verse 6, "I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you." Sometimes we feel like, hey, you know, life is okay. You know, I haven't sinned or anything, you know. But think about your community. Think about your nation. How you, as a citizen of that nation, can come before God and confess the sins of the people that you belong to. It's important for us to do so. God wants to, if you humble yourself before the Lord, remember 2 Chronicles 7:14, I will hear your prayer. Heal your land. A lot of humbling has to be done in our world, I believe, as we confess the sins not only of our own individual self, our father's house, so to speak, also, but also of the nation. Nehemiah knew that for God to hear his prayers on behalf of the people, he needed to be realistic about the disobedience of the people of God, including himself. Understand that our prayers and our ability to be used of God are hindered by sin. The psalmist wrote, "If I regard wickedness in my heart, the Lord will not hear." How do we become righteous before the Lord? So that he'll hear our prayers. First of all, we need to deal with our affairs. Where have we been broken? What needs to be healed in our hearts? And confess before the Lord. If we confess and repent of our sin, God cleans us and makes us able to be used. Nehemiah knew that he needed to confess his sins and confess the sins of his people. And so he did so. The Apostle John wrote in his first letter of John, verse 8 through 9, these words, "If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to purify us from all unrighteousness." That word "all" means all. Don't ever forget that. All unrighteousness. Thirdly, Nehemiah's prayer was based on God's word. It included a reminder of God's gracious promises given through Moses and quotes nearly word from word verses out of Deuteronomy chapter 4, 9, and chapter 30. He is a God of forgiveness, a God of restoration, a God of great power, a God of redemption. When all seems lost, God can rescue, restore, and make it better than it was before. And this reminds me of Jesus' teaching in the parable of the prodigal son. Remember that parable? Even when we're at the bottom of life, skid row, if you will, destitute, when we repent, when we turn to God, God will graciously welcome us back and restore us fully into the family of God. When we know God's promises, we are better able to pray confidently and effectively. Praying the Word of God. So important to get the Word of God into our hearts and minds so we can pray it back to Him. God loves it when He hears His Word repeated back because He knows that we know His Word. Remember, as a parent, when your children came back to you and you heard your words coming out of their mouths, hopefully they were the good side of them. But that's what's going on as we interact with God's word and we pray God's word. Fourthly, after getting right with God, that's when Nehemiah asks for help with King Artaxerxes, recognizing that God can move any human heart to accomplish his will. Nehemiah may have been encouraged that God had placed him in a strategic position as cupbearer to the king. But he was also in a very dangerous and precarious predicament to go before the king without being summoned and to ask something of this nature when the king hadn't brought up the subject. People were known to be killed on the spot for such a thing. I believe that after days of prayer and fasting, God gave Nehemiah the faith and the courage to proceed for the benefit of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. Scholar Marvin Brennerman wrote these words: Nehemiah's greatness came from asking great things of a great God and attempting great things in reliance on him. You know, I find it really encouraging that God will use ordinary people, give them a compassion to do great things, and then God gets the glory when the great things are accomplished. What kind of great things have we thought about? What has God placed on our hearts and our minds that we might be in prayer about, waiting for God's guidance to accomplish? If we're going to attempt great things, and why not? Then our first step is to be dependent upon our great God for that guidance and help, to go to him in prayer, fast if we need to keep focused on what we're praying for till we get an answer. And then when we get our marching orders, going for it with confidence that God is behind it and he'll provide. He will give direction and open the doors to all power brokers that need to be involved. It's amazing what God will do. If you've ever been a part of the beginning of a new church where you're looking for land and building a building, it's amazing how God provides when the people of God in that little community that gathered together and they know God has called them to be a congregation, and then suddenly resources are there and mortgages are paid faster than anybody ever believed. Isn't that right, Rain? I've heard the stories of grace, particularly from our elder Wayne Campbell, about these wonderful ways that God provided and ordinary people accomplished great things for the Lord. And here we are in this worship space, a beacon of light in a world of darkness. So if we are tempted to think that someone else should fix the world and not us, then think about this. God calls us all to make a difference in the lives of others. We're just called to do different things. Each one of us have a mission in this life that God has called. He's given us gifts to pursue these missions, these ministries. So let me conclude with this question. Do we want to be better people, people who have compassion for others and want to be part of something bigger than ourselves? The answer is yes, then the place to start is in prayer. I can't say it enough. You can't neglect this step, going before the Lord. And when you get your marching orders, that's when you know what to do. Year ahead, I believe, is full of challenges for our nation, our community, and for Grace Presbyterian. Hey, your PNC is about to begin that process of interviewing and talking and reviewing resumes of candidates that are possible pastors for this congregation. It's going to be an exciting time. So we need to be in prayer for them, and they need to be in prayer, asking for God's guidance. But this community is changing all around us. We've got quite a homeless situation, immigration issues are starting to arrive. There's going to be a lot of refugees. What has God placed on our heart to help? What about the ethnic shift that's going on? The people that don't particularly look like us or act like us or even speak the same language, but they're here. God placed them on your heart. What about the widows? Widowers, what about the children? We need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Who has God put on your heart is building compassion for you to respond to share the gospel, the good news of deliverance from sin, darkness, into life in Jesus Christ. Boy, there's not a better message. Our world needs redemption. And God will use us to proclaim the Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this passage. Thank you for Nehemiah, who responded to your call on his life, the compassion that you gave him for the people of Israel and the city of Jerusalem. Thank you that he's a great model for us, an encouragement for us to not think of ourselves as just one person who doesn't have any abilities, but that we are people of God. We are members of the family of God, who calls each one of us and empowers us to do his will. Thank you, Lord, that you are more powerful than anything in this world, and through your power, through us, we can accomplish great things. Don't ever let us forget that. But help us remain in your word, to pray according to your will as we align ourselves with you, and to seek great things for you, O God. You are a great God, and you do great things. Help us to always remember that. So, God, we want to lift up to you our nation that's still struggling with many pockets of COVID pandemic, and we ask for your protection. We ask, Lord, for healing for those who may be struggling with this virus, and we pray, God, deliverance and healing for them. We pray, Lord, for the world that is still struggling, for many areas of the world that this virus is running rampant in, and we pray, God, for deliverance and healing and protection for them as well. And we pray, oh God, for those families that are struggling because of the fires that has burned out their homes and livelihoods. We pray for reconstruction and redemption for them. We pray, O Lord, for those who are still reeling from the floods and the hurricanes in the south. And we pray again, Lord, for redemption, for reconstruction, for renewal. We pray, Lord, for individuals in our congregation who are sick, struggling with cancers and flus and other ailments. Pray, Lord, for those who are struggling with blood clots, those who are struggling with broken bones or dislocated joints. We pray, Lord, that you would knit all of this back together again and bring freedom and movement. And we're so grateful, Lord, that you hear our prayers and respond to them, reminding ourselves of the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Let's stand together and sing hymn, what number is it? I don't remember, but 427, "Dear Lord and Father of All Mankind."
Thank you.
This praise song that we're about to lead you in is a song about redemption, and it is a celebrative song of God's redeeming power in our lives. It's okay to clap and rejoice as you sing, as you listen, as you enter into the spirit of this song, because our God is Redeemer. He is our Lord and Savior, and He's here with us today.
If you're able, would you please rise?
Give you a little break, right?
I'll raise a banner.
I'll
Just a little celebrative time. We can leave here with joy today. Our Redeemer does live. A little punctuation point. All right, well, we hope that you have a great week. And don't forget, if you have some special need for prayer, back in the bride's room, we're going to have a little prayer team waiting to pray with you. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. And everyone said,
Amen.
Have a great week, everyone.